Open your Bibles. I will gather my thoughts on the way into the message. We're going to Revelation chapter 15 today. Oh my, is it a heavy message today. Oh man. Title of the message, The Wheels of Justice. The Wheels of Justice. We're going to do the entire chapter, Revelation 15, but don't fret, it's only 8 verses. I'll manage to stretch it out though, you watch. There's an ancient Greek saying that's been adopted and adapted and used and misused since, I suppose, the ancient Greeks wrote it. One of the adaptations of it is what I'm using for the title today. It's this. The wheels of justice turn slow, but they grind exceedingly fine. The wheels of justice turn slow, but they grind exceedingly fine. These wheels are speaking of the wheels of a mill, like a grinding mill. One of the original adaptations of the Greek saying is, the Christians, they say, the mills of God. The mills of God grind slowly, but they grind exceedingly fine. Speaking of the slowness of the grinding of justice, we see it in our country, don't we? Don't we see sometimes, don't we wonder how slow justice is? You might be surprised, probably not, but you might be, to know that the national average for a person on death row is 12 years. In California, it's 20 years. Average time on death row, 20 years. The wheels of justice turn slowly, but eventually they grind exceedingly fine. How much truer is that with God, man? If that's true in our country, how much truer is it with God? Genesis chapter 3, Adam, as the federal head of mankind, brought sin into the world on your behalf. You can thank him for that someday. And he passed that sin gene on to every single one of us, Genesis chapter 3. And since that day, God has been in the process of bringing justice unto sin in this world. Since Genesis chapter 3, talk about justice, the wheels of justice moving slowly. After a few thousand years, God spent 1,500 years in the Old Testament convincing us by picture, by type, by illustration, that our only hope to escape the justice that is due upon sin is a Savior. We need a Savior. We need to be redeemed. That's what the entire Old Testament is about. So then God, after convincing us we need a Savior, sent one. He sent Jesus Christ, right? And since Jesus Christ came as that Savior, as the only escape, the only option besides receiving the judgment that is justly due sin, God has given us 2,000 plus years to get the message out that justice is due upon sin, it must come upon sin, but there is a way of escape, that's Jesus Christ. And so for those who have met Jesus as their Savior, for those who are following him, justice upon your sin has been met. Justice has been met. The full penalty has been paid. You have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. However, for the world that rejects God's only answer for sin, justice must still come. Justice must still come. There's a day and there's a place when God's final justice will be brought. The day is already set. And in Revelation, the beginning of that final day of justice being brought upon sin starts in Revelation chapter 15. Are you getting a feeling it's an ominous message coming today? It is. The wheels of God's justice turn slowly, but they grind exceedingly fine. You ready to pray? Let's. Heavenly Father, please show us, Lord. God, the equal balance of your glory. Lord, we want to know your glory and your grace and in your mercy and in your salvation. And Lord, we want to know your equal glory and your justice, in your judgment, and even in your wrath, Lord. And so we pray, God, for that deeper knowledge of your glory, that deeper understanding, Lord, of who you are. God, may we know that you are first and foremost holy and just and righteous, and that you must judge sin, Lord. And God, may it cause us to cling tighter to our Savior, Lord. And God, if Jesus, if you're not our Savior, may it cause us to run to you and to never fall away, Lord. Show us the reality that your judgment and justice upon sin must ultimately come. We pray you make our hearts ready for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Our last message was titled, Remember, Jesus Wins. It was a really good message to prepare us for chapter 15. I think we have some DVDs of last week's message, and they're master DVDs, so they got the menu and they're all prettied up. So grab one of those from Pam if you weren't here last week. It was an encouraging message. If you're a believer today, it's an ominous message. Still encouraging if you're a believer, but not so much if you're not. It's an ominous and a solemn message today about the justice of God coming against sin. I think that might be why Revelation chapter 15 is the shortest chapter in the book of Revelation, because I hope you'll say at the end today, okay, I get it. I get it. You're going to see the judgment fall next week, our next message in 16, but today we start the wheels turning. Here we go, Revelation 15, verse 1. John says, "Then I saw another sign in heaven, great and amazing, seven angels with seven plagues, which are the last. For with them the wrath of God is finished." This is it. We've arrived at the beginning of the end. This is an incredibly huge event, and you have got to grasp that we're talking about, 3,500 years, or so since sin entered the world, at least 4,000 years. Don't get all long day on me. It's been a long time. It's been a long time that God has patiently waited for the world to receive his answer to the judgment that must come upon sin. This is the beginning of that final judgment, that final justice coming. It's like the final day for a death row inmate. I know you may not like to talk about this or hear about this, but just grip your hands or something and listen, because it applies. Death row inmate can sit on death row for 20 years in California, seemingly alive, but he's actually dead. The execution just hasn't occurred yet. When he's walking, you know the movie, they holler out, "Dead man walking." Because he seems alive, but he's really dead. And so finally, maybe after 15 or 20 years, that day comes. And when that day comes, judgment occurs swiftly. Not quickly, as in quickly after his sentencing, but when it comes swiftly and it comes complete. It's finished. That's how it is with God. But how much more so has God exhibited his patience and his long suffering with the sin of the world? But then ultimately, when the judgment must come, it comes. Consider Noah and the flood. For how long did God wait? While the world just got worse and worse and worse. But once the earth opened and the flood came, it was complete. How about Sodom and Gomorrah and God's interaction with Abraham, which shows such mercy and grace? God did everything he could in putting in Abraham the request for the prayer to show mercy to Sodom and Gomorrah. But eventually the day came, and when it came, judgment was complete. It was swift and it was complete. How about the Pharaoh in Egypt? Egypt. I mean, there's some patience with God. Just patient, 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 waiting with the Pharaoh. But eventually, when judgment came, it came swift and it came complete. Same with the nation of Israel when they were taken into captivity. God gave them so long, so many prophets to get them to turn back to him. But finally, Babylon came ultimately after the Syrians and Babylon came in the south and took Israel out. God's judgment came swift when the day came. And when it comes with righteousness, it comes with justice, and listen carefully, it comes with the full wrath of God. We need to hear this. Here's what the famous preacher, great preacher, H.A. Ironside says. Ironside says this about this verse. God has given us these revelations out of kindness to us, that we may be warned thereby to avoid what lies ahead of this guilty world. You know why Satan doesn't want you to believe in him? Because he doesn't want you to have a reason to turn from him. You know why he's getting most of the church to at least imply that hell's not that bad or not that real or not eternal? He's getting the church to do that so that people don't have a reason to turn from their sin. But as we say all the time, if God would just suspend us over hell for 2 or 3 seconds, we would never question our commitment to him again. If we just had a glimpse, but then it wouldn't take faith. But hell is real. And the reason Jesus talks so much is about hell is so that you don't go there. That's why he talked about it. That's why we're reading Revelation 15. And so to that end, to that warning, John sees another great and amazing sign in verse 1, the beginning of God's final judgment. Verse 2 continues in Revelation 15. John says, "And I saw what appeared to be a sea of glass mingled with fire." A sea of glass mingled with fire. The first time we saw this sea of glass was back in chapter 4, and we said that it seems to be a transparent sea surrounding the throne of God. Much like when we talk about heaven having streets of gold. Well, the literal interpretation of that word is really transparent. It's transparent streets. It's something that we have a hard time grasping. But John sees this sea of glass mingled with fire. Think about this. It looks a little bit like a Red Sea. Just remember that. It's a little bit of a play on words. A sea of glass mingled with fire. We'll call it a Red Sea. Continuing in verse 2 of Revelation 15, "And also," John saw, "and also those who had conquered the beast and its image and the number of its name, standing beside," or could be translated upon, "beside or upon the sea of glass, with harps of God in their hands." That's pretty cool. Those harps are what King David played, called a lyre, that looks a lot like our guitar. So maybe, you know, you would prefer to think of a harp. I prefer maybe a Les Paul Sunburst or Paul Reed Smith, maybe. Yeah, so they're all given guitars in my mind. Harps. They're given harps of God in their hands. But look at really close. This is another special group of tribulation saints. We keep seeing these special groups of tribulation saints. Why? Because God wants to show us victory in the midst of tribulation. So here's another group that is victorious in the tribulation. This group has conquered. Look at the three things it's conquered there. They have conquered in verse 2. They've conquered the beast. They've conquered his image. And they've conquered his number. Now, we've just seen in the last couple of messages, the Antichrist and the false prophet do everything they can to bring worship from the world ultimately to the beast, which is ultimately Satan and his cohorts, the Antichrist and the false prophet. They've done everything, right? They've tried deception, fake miracles, probable false resurrection, and then they've tried force, and ultimately they tried a threat of death if they didn't accept the mark. And this group that John sees in verse 2 are those who stood faithful in that fire. Listen carefully because it applies to you. This is the group that stood faithful in the fire against the Antichrist and all of the Antichrist ways of the final tribulation. They chose life with God over life on this earth. Remember, this applies to you. They chose life with God over life on this earth. And in verse 2 of Revelation 15, they're being rewarded for that. As we see them standing on or beside this transparent sea of glass, with fire, with harps in their hands. They refused to worship the beast. They refused to worship the image that they were told to worship. They refused to take the mark, indicating that they did worship the beast. But please hear me. This is what I want you to hear. What the world thought was life was really death. And what the world thought was death was really life. That is as applicable today as it will be in the final tribulation. Here's what I'm talking about. The world thought that taking the mark of the beast was actually life. Was it? Read Revelation 14. Listen, the world thought that if I take this mark, if I just bow down to this guy and his image, then I'll have life. But what was the truth? The truth is Revelation 14 says that anyone who takes that mark is tormented forever. Listen, read about it, man. It says the torment never ends. Day and night, eternal torment. In that place that we call hell, what the world thought was life was really death. And then the world saw these crazy Christians, and there's a bunch of them. There's a bunch of Christians in the tribulation. And they're saying no, and they're standing strong against the Antichrist. And so they get killed, and the world says, oh, see, that's death. Is it death? Say no. It looks like death to the world, but what is it? It's life. It's life. And it's not life in this puny, temporal, stinky world of ours. It's eternal life in the presence of God standing on the transparent sea with the rocking Les Paul ready to worship. You know what I'm saying? Or a harp. Ring, ring, ring. You know, whatever works for you. Listen, what the world thinks is death for you as a Christian is life. Oh, dude, you got all religious on us, man. You're not gonna like inhale glue anymore, man. What's wrong with you? Come on, let's go burn some brain cells, man, and get worthless. They honestly think that if you start following God, you've died, but what's happening? They think they're alive, but they're dead. They think you're dead, but what? You're alive. Just flip it around. That's what it really is. Amen? Amen? Don't give in. Don't give in to the world, man. Don't say, oh, yeah, it's true. The pleasures of the day, you know, they're good. They're worth it. They're not worth it. Don't give in. Cling to Jesus. Follow him. Hold fast because this world is short and it's... Yeah. Listen, I'm trying really hard not to say something I shouldn't say. You're wondering what it is, huh? Okay, I'll just tell you. This world sucks. It just does. I mean, get it straight, man. This world ain't it. What Jesus Christ has it for us. We're citizens of heaven. There's glory waiting for us. And the only reason we're still in this miry world is to get someone else to come to glory with us. Man, you got to get hung up on the right world, man. And it's not this one, it's that one. So moving on, the saints who had conquered the beast by their faith in God, they're standing on the Red Sea, catch it, the Red Sea, the glass sea mingled with fire. Verse 2 says they're part of the worship team, which is very cool. They're given harps of God. And verse 3 says they're singing praises to God. This is so appropriate after the worship we just were part of. And by the way, you were part of it. Oh, man, I walked over here and turned around to you guys for a minute, and it's like, wow, you guys were singing. You were singing. I was so proud of you. Man, all right, Revelation 15, verse 3, these saints are singing too, and they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb. The song of Moses is the first song of deliverance in the Bible. You find it in Exodus 15. I'm going to read about it in a second. It's when the Jewish nation, listen carefully, because it's a parallel teaching. The Jewish nation had just begun, really completed the Exodus from Egypt. They had just left Egypt when they sang this song. And in the next message, we're going to see that the final seven bold judgments are very similar, almost parallel to the plagues of Egypt. Now listen carefully, because this is super cool. So the song of Moses was the song of deliverance that was sung after the people received exited, I don't know if that's the right word, after the exodus from Egypt. Well, Egypt is always a picture of the world and of being enslaved to the sin of the world. And so the Song of Moses came as a deliverance song after the people of God exited, after they left the bondage, were freed from the bondage and slavery to the world pictured by Egypt. Do you get it? All right, please do. And so these saints here today have also had an exodus from the bondage of the world, haven't they? They have received their exodus from the tribulation world, the bondage to the tribulation world, and you're going to see in a next message that the plagues that come, the final seven bold judgments, very similar to the plagues in Egypt. Here's how it worked. The final plague in Egypt was what? I'll just tell you. It was death of the firstborn, but here's the point, is that all of God's people were saved by the final plague by being under the covering of the blood of the Lamb. And so the Exodus actually came for God's people in Exodus under the covering of the blood of the Lamb. These tribulation saints also had an Exodus out of the world, out of bondage and enslavement to the world, under the covering of the blood of the Lamb. Let me just put up a couple of verses from Exodus 15, this song of Moses, because it's really cool. Here they are, just a few. Verse 1. Then Moses and the people of Israel sang this song to the Lord, saying, I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. That's a great worship song right there. This is my God, and I will praise him. Skip into verse 7. In the greatness of your majesty, you overthrow your adversaries. You send out your fury. It consumes them like stubble. And we need to understand that what we saw in the Red Sea with Pharaoh and his army chasing God's people who were being redeemed, if you will, from slavery, is we saw a total and complete judgment upon the army of Egypt as God swallowed them in the Red Sea. God gave them time, but in the end, his judgment was complete. So this song was sung at the first Exodus when the people were redeemed from the slavery of the world, and it's sung here at the last Exodus in the world, the tribulation. Next, Isaiah, listen carefully. Isaiah prophesied in chapter 12. Isaiah prophesied that there would be a day that when God would bring his people home, that they would sing the song of Moses. And we saw that happen when Israel began to return to Jerusalem after the Babylonian captivity. We saw that kind of happen, but guys, listen, ultimately, the Song of Moses is going to be sung when God's people are returned to him from the ultimate Babylon. So this Song of Moses is this thread of redemption from slavery, from Exodus through Isaiah all the way to Revelation. Listen carefully, please. These books have been, they're written, 1,500 years apart, let's just say, for talking. And they tell the same story. From Exodus to Isaiah to Revelation is the same story. There will be a song of deliverance sung when God removes his people from the enslavement of the world. So if God can do that and bring justice from Exodus to Isaiah to Revelation, can he do it in your life? This is the question. If God can bring his people out of Egypt, if God can bring his people out of Babylon, if God can bring his people out of the final tribulation, can he bring you through what you're going through? Yes, he can. He can and he will. But you have a role in it. You have got to cling to him. You've got to stand against the world. You've got to cling to Christ and trust him and follow him. And God will bring you through just like he has his saints from Egypt into Babylon, or from Babylon and from the tribulation. That is a really cool, I just love it when the Bible shows this single message from beginning to end, which it shows all the time. But that's the miraculous proof of our Bible. Next, not just the song of Moses hurrying, but it says also they sing the song of the Lamb. Warren Wiersbe was nice enough to point out to me that in Luke chapter 9, write this down in your margin, it's pretty cool. Luke 9:31, this is Luke's version of the Mount of Transfiguration when Jesus was on the Mount of Transfiguration with Moses and Elijah. Well, Luke 9:31 says this. It says the three of them were speaking of the exodus of Jesus. This is cool because it ties this exodus in from Exodus to Revelation. Luke 9:31, your Bible probably says departure, but if you'll just get out your Greek lexicon, you'll see that the Greek word there is actually exodus. They came and were speaking to Christ about his exodus, which he was about to complete. He was leading. He was our pioneer. It was our exodus out of the bondage of the world that Jesus was about to accomplish. Guys, listen, there's a physical exodus from the book of Exodus and from Babylon and even in the tribulation, but Jesus Christ provides the spiritual exodus. And so these saints are singing the song of Moses, praising God for his physical deliverance, and they're singing the song of the Lamb, praising God for his spiritual deliverance. Amen? Okay, it might be a little bit deep, but it's really cool. All right. Song of the Lamb doesn't seem to have a certain verse. Like we can't say, oh, Song of the Lamb, that's in this chapter, this verse, because it's all through the New Testament. The Song of the Lamb is praising Christ for his salvation and his victory. That's what you should be praising Jesus Christ for, his salvation and his victory, because he has saved you completely and he already is completely victorious. But to just give you a little bit of an idea of the Song of the Lamb, back in Revelation 5, verse 9, just write it down and you could check it later. The 24 elders representing who? Say us. Us, the 24 elders representing us, are around the throne, and they fall down before the throne. They fall down before the Lamb to worship the Lamb. Each of them also is given a Gibson Les Paul Sunburst Classic Edition. No, they're each given a harp. The other thing, that's a paraphrase. They're each given a harp, and they're all worshiping around the throne. The elders, that's us. And they're given a new song to sing. In Revelation 5, verse 9 says this, worthy are you, this is the 24 elders representing the church around the throne, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God. That's the salvation part. From every tribe and language and people and nation, here's the victory part. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. So we see there in Revelation chapter 5, as the representatives of the church are falling before the throne, they're singing the song of the Lamb and praising him for his salvation and for his victory. You can praise him for that too, if he is for you personally. If you have committed your life to him, then know that he has saved you and you will reign with him. Amen? All right, back to Revelation 15. Let's get back to the verse by verse. Not only are they singing the song of Moses and the song of the Lamb, but it seems like as verse 3 continues, they're adding their own praise. This is right from this group. Verse 3 continues, second half. They were saying, great and amazing are your deeds, O Lord God the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Who will not fear, verse 4 says, O Lord, and glorify your name, for you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you, for your righteous acts have been revealed. Listen, guys, we're looking at the wheels of God's judgment. They're moving slow, but they grind exceedingly fine. And maybe you're thinking, hey, let's get to the heavy stuff. Well, this seems like all praise, but here's what I need you to connect in your mind. It is praise for God's judgment. We try to avoid God's judgment and just praise him when he gives us good stuff. But the Bible praises God for his judgment, for his justice, and even for his wrath. We need to realize that God's justice is just as holy as his grace. That God's justice is just as important to praise him for as his grace. They're both God. He must judge sin, and he offers you grace. But we praise him for both because the Bible does. And so here, we see the saints worshiping him for his grace and for his justice because the world will know. Listen, this is a truth right now. Every knee will bow. Philippians 2 says, every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And just in case you know what this means, that's not universalism. All right? That doesn't mean everybody gets saved. I mean, some people are going to bow by choice and some are going to bow by force. But every knee is going to bow. And every tongue is going to recognize that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's what Revelation 15:4 is saying. Great and amazing are God's works. Just and true are his ways. The world will have a reverent fear of God. Do you see it? Who will not fear, O Lord, and glorify your name? It means everybody will have that reverent awe and fear of God, including those who don't believe. The world will have a reverent fear of God. They'll glorify his name, for he alone is holy. There will be a day, there's coming a day when all nations, end of verse 4, will come and worship him, for his righteous acts have been revealed. Reference to the millennium, when the entire world will be under the righteous reign of Jesus Christ. That's a big deal. Guys, we need to see God's holiness in both his justice and his grace. God is just as holy, in fact, more holy in his judgment than he is in his mercy. We need to hear it. We need to understand it, and we need to make decisions in our life accordingly. So now all of heaven comes to attention. This is the kind of the finale. It seems to me like heaven is in awe at this point, like they know, like heaven knows. Revelation 15, verse 5, John says, after this I looked, and the sanctuary of the tent of witness in heaven was opened. The NLT helps us here. NLT of same verse, Revelation 15, 5, says, then I looked and saw that the temple in heaven, God's tabernacle, it means his dwelling place, God's tabernacle was thrown wide open. Like when the veil was torn from top to bottom when Christ was crucified. And the inner sanctuary, the Holy of Holies, the place where God dwelt, was thrown wide open because access was given to all under the blood of Christ. Now John looks into heaven and he sees what is as holy and as powerful as anything gets. He sees the inner sanctuary of God in heaven thrown wide open. The last time, this is important to connect chronology, the last time heaven was open was when the seventh trumpet blew. Do you remember me saying, please say yes. Just, you know, for this one moment, it's okay to lie. Just say yes, you remember. You know, not after this though. Do you remember I said that the seventh trumpet actually brings the seven bowl judgments, that within the seventh judgment is actually the seven bowl judgments? Say yes. Yeah, I knew you'd remember. Listen, the last time heaven was open was when the seventh trumpet blew, which I told you, that's the beginning of the seven bowl judgments. Here it is, Revelation 11, verse 9. I'll just put it on the screen. You write it down in Revelation 15, right there in your margin. Revelation 11:19 connects here. Then God's temple in heaven was opened, and the ark of his covenant was seen within his temple. There were flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, an earthquake, and heavy hail. And back when we were teaching chapter 11, I was saying, man, heaven is being rocked. The doors are swung open. It's a big deal. And then from chapter 12 to chapter 14, John focused on other critical events. See, Revelation is not always chronological, right? And so from 12 to 14, John changes his focus. And then here in chapter 15, he goes, hey, remember, something awesome is happening in heaven. The seventh trumpet caused the beginning of the seven bowl judgments, which are the final bowl judgments, the final wrath of God. And so we're back at that heavenly event. It's a big deal. The inner sanctuary of the temple is thrown wide open in verse 5. And it seems to me like at this point, instead of all of the radical stuff that we saw in chapter 11 when the temple is open, it seems to me like you could hear a pin drop in heaven now. Like something very ominous, something very solemn is about to occur. Verse 6 of Revelation 15 says, and out of the sanctuary came the seven angels. Out of the sanctuary, out of the inner sanctuary of God. Out of the sanctuary came the seven angels with the seven plagues, clothed in pure, bright linen with golden sashes around their chests. See, it's hard for us to imagine all of the specifics, but something occurs here where the innermost holy of holies in heaven, of which both the tabernacle and the temple are a picture of, the innermost holy of holies opens. And it's a little bit like royalty, you know, walking in the room maybe, but times a billion. So the inner sanctuary opens and out comes seven angels. And they're carrying with them the seven last plagues, and heaven knows. This is God's final judgment about to be poured out on the earth. They're in bright linen. That's the clothing of the Old Testament priest. It represents righteousness. They have a gold sash around their chest, which represents deity. Gold always represents deity. So these seven angels are the high priest. They are the priests in God's holy of holies. So, you know, God's at the top of the chain, and he sends these seven angels out to do his work as priests. Heaven standing at attention, I believe, in awe, because they know something big is coming. Verse 7 of Revelation 15 says, and one of the four living creatures gave to the seven angels seven golden bowls full of the wrath of God. Now, if you haven't studied the wrath of God much, let me just tell you, seven bowls full is a lot of wrath. It's all the wrath that is due upon the sin of the world. It is the final wrath due upon the sin of the world. The only thing I could connect it to is the world being on death row and walking into that final chamber where they line up six or seven needles, you know. In fact, some of your Bibles say vials. Poor choice of words because it makes us think of a test tube, but maybe like seven, you know, execution vials. But it's actually the word for bowl. It's a large, shallow bowl, and they are full to the brim with the final wrath of God. Who gives them the seven bowls? Look carefully at verse 7. It's one of the four living creatures. Now listen, you got to make this connection. The four living creatures, we met them back in Revelation chapter 4 in verse 8. Let me just read to you. Well, let me tell you first. The four living creatures, we said back in chapter 4, these are special, unique beings of worship. They serve in worship nonstop around the throne of God. Here's Revelation 4, verse 8 tells us about them. And the four living creatures never cease to say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. These creatures never stop worshiping around the throne. Please connect this. The primary creatures, beings, we just call them creatures or beings because They're like nothing you can imagine. If you read about them in chapter 4, these beings are worship beings. And they are the ones who hand the wrath of God to the instruments, the angels who will pour the wrath out. Wait a minute. God just connected worship to judgment. God just connected worship to judgment. Please hear me. Do not just worship God when he gives you a new car, okay? Because the devil can give you 10. Worship God in his chastisement. Worship God in his discipline. Worship God in the difficulty of life. Because worship goes with judgment, not just what we associate it with, you know, like good feelings. Those in charge of worship hand the bowls of wrath to the angels who will pour them out. That's a big deal. Heaven knows this is it. Heaven knows the inner sanctuary has been thrown open. These seven angels come out, and it's a solemn and an ominous thing. And heaven knows the justice of God. The wheels of the justice of God turn slow, but they grind exceedingly fine, and we are at the doorstep of the final execution of his judgment. Verse 8, Revelation 15, an ominous and powerful and a holy moment. Verse 8 says, and the sanctuary was filled with smoke from the glory of God and from his power. No one could enter the sanctuary until the seven plagues of the seven angels were finished. Twice on earth this has occurred, at the tabernacle and at the dedication of the temple, when the glory of God came with such power that the smoke filled the tabernacle and the temple. For the tabernacle, Moses couldn't go into the meeting place because of the glory of God. For the temple, the Levites couldn't go in and worship because the glory of God was too powerful. And now in heaven, it's called the antitype, but don't get hung up on it. What is a type on earth, the actual is called the antitype in heaven. So the tabernacle and the temple are a picture or a type on earth. Well, what the reality of that in heaven, the temple in heaven, is now filled with smoke from the glory and the power of God. John is trying to convey to us, this is it, man. It is coming down, and it's going to come down with a fury like the world has never seen. This is Revelation. Not just is Jimmy Carter the Antichrist. This is Revelation. It's the only name I could think of. Revelation is about the justice of God coming to pass. This is it. Revelation 16:1. The day of sentencing has been reached. Justice is about to be done. It can wait no longer. And so we look ahead into the next message and read in Revelation 16:1. Then I heard a loud voice from the temple telling the seven angels, go and pour out on the earth the seven bowls of the wrath of God. And with that, the final justice is done on earth. The final judgment begins. Listen as we close, please. A man can sit on death row for 20 years thinking he's alive. But there's a morning when his time on death row is up. And his execution will come swiftly that day. And it will be complete. And I want you to know that this world is under a death sentence. This world is on death row. And God is holy and just and righteous to bring justice against sin upon the sin of this world. And that day is coming. Now listen, here are two types of people in this world. There's one type of person who just tries to make their time on death row better. Oh, I just want a, you know, a extra rare ribeye, you know, with a double baked potato. Listen, man, I don't care what you eat for your last meal. You're about to die. I just want to make my time here better. How many people do you know on death row in this world who are just trying to make their time better? Really? Honestly? You think that car and that stuff and that house and that girl or whatever it is, you think that stuff is somehow going to improve your time on death row? It's not. It's not. But Jesus Christ came to death row to offer you a pardon. And he'll walk right up to your cell and say, listen, I will take your penalty upon myself and I will release you with a full pardon. And how in the world can the world say, no, I think I'll just improve my time on death row here. Thanks for the offer, but no thanks. I'm good. If I could just get, you know, Bruce Willis DVD to improve my time in here, I'm good. No, don't do it. Don't do it. Jesus Christ is offering the world a full pardon from death row, man. Take it. Because the execution is coming. And when God brings it, it's going to be swift and it's going to be complete because our sin must be paid for. Either by Jesus Christ in our place or by us if we choose to sit it out until the execution day. We are at the beginning of the end of the book of Revelation. It gets really rough from here on until we win in 19. But between here and 19, man, is rough for unbelievers. I believe this world is at the beginning of the end. Please, don't try to improve your stay on death row. Don't do it. Accept the free gift of a complete pardon from Jesus Christ and allow him to move you off of death row into an eternal mansion. Doesn't this make sense? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, when you say it like that, Lord, it makes sense. Lord, we want the pardon. We want the pardon, Lord. God, we accept that your judgment is coming. May we accept your pardon. May we accept the free gift of your salvation, Lord, your offer to take our judgment in our place and instead to give us the righteousness that you have before God. If that's you today, man, cry out quick before you have a heart attack and fall over in the aisle. I'm serious. Cry out to God, man. Cry out to God because the moment you take your last breath is done. Hebrews says, it is appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. Right now, say, God, save me. Save me. Lord Jesus, come into my life. I repent of my sin. I turn from the world. I turn from the pleasures of the world. I turn to you, Lord. I desire the pleasures for eternity instead of the pleasures for a moment. Heal me. Forgive me of my sin, Lord. Forgive me, forgive me, forgive me. Make me right. Make me right before you, Lord. Make me right. Come into my life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and make me a follower, Lord. I surrender now. Thank you for saving me. It's in your name I pray. Amen.